Why do we
do you have projects for your constituency?
Of course, there are projects.
It goes to how much?
In my constituency. I give you an example, like the Kanofim village. The Kanofim village, how many people are actors or how many people are cinematographers from my village? How many people? How many people are cameramen? How many people are involved in the film industry from my village? For goodness sake. That is a project that is going to take a couple of billions to complete. Is it the people of my village that are going to benefit from that?
But you influenced that. But you influenced it.
Of course, because it's a massive vision.
That's not the only project.
It's the second of its kind.
That is not the only project that is in question here. There are other projects that you said that you have influenced on a rejuvenating.
Well, the point is that for the speaker and his cohorts, while they were busy inserting all sort of projects, viewing centers, town halls, and all sort of things, as a lawmaker, one of your responsibilities is to take projects. But if you want to take projects, take a project that will be useful to people. Take a project that has a massive vision. The Kanowood is employing about 20,000 youths. By the time you put the film village, it will be employing about 250,000 youths. It will also amount to revenue to the federal government. It will become the center or the center of film industry in the whole of West Africa. So it's a massive vision. Then again, we've not really used our film to promote our own culture, our own economic potentials. It has generated a lot of controversy now in Kano because Speaker Dogara, using one member from Kano, went there and sold it to the religious community leaders in Kano that it is meant to be a disco center, a club center in Kano. And I asked, don't we have Islamic movies? Aren't we going to do history on our great leaders? We don't have standard films on the Zeeks, on the Awos, on the Ahmadu Bello, on our traditional rulers, traditional institutions, our potentials. Aren't we even going to have film on President Buhari himself?
There are layers of betrayal from your perspective of your colleagues now. Are you happy that you are betraying them one more time?
About what?
About these very allegations you are putting forward.
Well, if these allegations are considered betrayal, so be it. A few days ago, I said something. It might be difficult for people to believe this, but I tell you this. In every system and in different sector in this country, there are people who are part of that system. Even if you are a product of establishment, yeah, you are part of it. But maybe something in you is not comfortable about the system, and there's nothing you can do about it until when there is a trigger. Everything you see me doing, to the best of my conscience, to the God that I'm going to die and go, and meet him when I live this life, that is my innermost. That is what I've always wanted to have the opportunity to do.
You're convinced you're doing the right thing?
Yeah. But when you are in a system, it is difficult for you to just stand up one day and start challenging the system. And I didn't even realize that I can now build this up. It was just a few days ago. And I said, look, this is a trigger. So maximize it. Since it's already an issue, let it not stop on only budget issue.
Honorable Jibrin, do you agree that you failed in some capacity as a chairman of the appropriation committee? Because the document which you oversaw did not even go through to the with the president. The president didn't assent to that. Are you not ashamed that some people will ask that the version of the document you work on could not be passed? It was the harmonized one by the deputy speaker that was eventually signed by the president.
Well, you can have it right all the time. Life itself is sweet and sour. I made a comment a few days ago, and it was misinterpreted in one of my tweets. And I said, though I'm not perfect, but I'm happy that I'm going to be 40 in September. And one of my greatest achievements is that I have finally discovered what I can live and die for. And I'm telling you this, I'm saying this from the bottom of my heart. I'm so glad that I've broken away from that cycle and I've embraced openly. All my life, I've tried to fight corruption internally because I will not pretend I'm a product of the establishment. So it's difficult for me. But now, even my mentors and my bosses will accept the fact that I have gone out of that cycle. You know why it's difficult sometimes? They will tell you, oh, you have a future. Nobody is going to trust you again. Nobody is going to deal with you again. I was telling my wife, I seated here 2 days ago. I said, I'm so glad, because that's not the kind of life I want to live after 40. So if you have anything you want to do and it's an illegality, if you hear the name of Jibril, run away. And why I'm happy is that I'm not outside the system. I'm inside the system.
But you've still not answered the question.
And I will make the
you've still not answered the question.
I will make the best use of my remaining time within the system.
That a document which you chaired on was not signed by the president. Are you not ashamed of that process?
I think, Shehu, you need to understand how the budgeting process works. This is not the first time that the budget is taken to the executive and it is not signed. And there's never been a time where the budget was taken just one time to the executive and the president assent. There's always an issue. That's why you hear this gray area.
Some of you have actually said you failed in the first place. That's why Deputy Speaker Lasso came to chair the harmonization committee.
The point I'm trying to make is that in several budget years, every budget session, you always have that issue. That is why this word became very prominent, the issue of gray areas. You always have gray areas. But usually, when it leaves the National Assembly and it goes to the executive arm of government, there is no so much public disclosure. Where the president disagrees, the Minister of Finance, then we don't have Minister of Budget, and of course the Director General of Budget Office, usually come up with the gray areas and discuss it with leadership of the National Assembly. And it is resolved, and the president will send it. But of course, you understand that this is a new government. This is the first time that we are having a change of government from one party to another. So there's a different way of doing things, different perception. And of course, you know the posture of the president. He's an extremely cautious person when it comes to such issues. And of course, the consultation was a bit weak between the executive and the National Assembly. You have the Deputy Speaker being aggrieved that he's not heading the consultation committee, the Speaker heading it. He doesn't have experience in budgeting system, and he wouldn't want to listen to anybody because he enjoys meeting MDAs, ministers, etc.
Honorable Abdulmumin Jibrin has been talking to us on China television about these allegations. We cannot take everything that he said over an hour interview, but we go on a short break, and when we come back, we dig deeper into this issue. Join us again.